Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for braving the rain. My name is Dan Liebenson, and I'm the executive director of the Johanna and Herman H. Neuberger Hillel Center here at the University of Chicago, which sponsors the Latke Hamantash debate every year. For those of you who are in Chicago, it's always the Tuesday before Thanksgiving at 7:30 p.m. at Mandel Hall. And I'm going to adjust to doing it this way because at Mandel Hall we have over 1,000 people standing room only because it usually snows around then, it doesn't rain. So if you were a student, when you were a student, we wanted to do this debate as a memory for students who came to the debate in the years that they were students, and for those who missed it when you were students, as a chance to see the debate in person. So I want to just say a few things. One, a lot of people, for some reason, and I don't realize that Hillel sponsors the Latke Hamantash debate, I always sort of wonder, well, who else do you think would sponsor it? But it is, what?
Manischewitz.
Good. You're right. But it is Hillel, and I did want to tell you a little bit about Hillel here at the University of Chicago. Hillel here has a storied history, went through many iterations, and now is also extremely successful. One thing that I wanted to share with you is that we have the UChicago here, and we also have JewChicago. And this is a serious thing. You can go to JewChicago.com and see how we're basically trying to present Jewish life to students as something that they can make their own by basically setting up the apps that they want to have. And we've been extremely successful engaging huge numbers of University of Chicago students. Just a few statistics, 1 in 4 students will go on a trip with Hillel to Israel or to somewhere else internationally or in the United States on an alternative spring break trip doing public service work. So 1 in 4 students will do that before they graduate. About 10% of all University of Chicago Jewish students will be Hillel interns before they graduate, which means that they have 100 hours of Jewish education and leadership training and do over 500 hours of work engaging their peers. We have just many other extremely successful programs and experiences, and if you'd like to learn more about those, we'd be glad to tell you. But this afternoon is really meant for humor, and so we will shift to that.
You better tell them when.
Yeah, when Ted comes up.
They may not know.
Yeah. And so this is the Latke Hamantash debate, and it's my job to basically introduce the contestants to you. There's the latke, which is a fried potato pancake, which for some reason that I've yet to figure out symbolizes Hanukkah, but has having something to do with the oil from the menorah that lasted for 8 days, instead of when it was only enough to last for 1 day. And the even harder to understand Hamantash, a triangular filled pastry, which has something to do with either Haman's pockets or ears, neither of which is referred to in the Purim story. So, but somehow or another, these have become the iconic Jewish foods, and the Latke Hamantash debate started 64 and a half years ago to try to figure out which one was the most superior. Really, the Latke Hamantash debate started in 1946, which was a dark time in Jewish history and a time when the students at the University of Chicago were looking for some way to enjoy being Jewish, and particularly around Christmas time, which was sort of a lonely time for them, and it was cooked up to have a Latke Hamantash debate and make being Jewish something that would be fun. That debate started with about 30 people at the Hillel building, and now, as I said, has over 1,000 people coming every year at Mandel Hall. So I just wanted to share with you a few of the recent Latke Hamantash debate posters, just so you can see that we try to connect it thematically. This was the 2008 version. This in 2009, it was actually the 150th anniversary of the Origin of Species publication, and we showed the evolution of the Latke and the Hamantash. And last year, we couldn't really think of anything, so we just tried a University of Chicago sort of theme of philosophy. But seriously, the Latke Hamantash debate really has made the careers of some University of Chicago professors, most recently, in the last 5 years, Professor Austin Goolsbee, who gave a very scholarly talk about the economics of Latkes and Hamantash, and then was, based on that, appointed by the president to the Council of Economic Advisors, and more...
Where he's been even funnier.
Right. And more relevantly, to The Daily Show and The Colbert Report, where he used those shops. And who can forget the president himself speaking here in introducing his symbol and its origins. But it's my job, really, to try to let everyone go home early by solving this from a Jewish standpoint. And I just wanted to give you a little bit of review of some of the ways that I've tried to do that over the last few years. At the 60th debate, I tried to focus on Jewish numerology, or gematria. In Judaism, every Hebrew letter is given a numerical value. And as you can see, sort of in the middle of the middle column, 60 was the letter Samech. And Samech can be drawn either this way in print or this way in script. And as you can imagine, that didn't help us very much to solve the problem. In the 62nd debate, that was the year of the presidential election, we tried something else. We tried to look at the names of the candidates as a Jewish text. And Jewish texts can be analyzed on four different levels of meaning, the pshat, Remez, Jerash, and Sod, that is the text, the subtext, the sort of mythic extrapolation meaning, and a secret meaning. And we looked for the text was really the names of the candidates, which didn't... and the idea was whoever won the election would have been the superior one. In principle, you would think that that would mean that the latke prevailed, but especially since we found that President Obama actually eats latkes at Manny's, which is a local deli. You can see it right here. It was reported that he ate latkes. Upon a deeper analysis, we saw that, first of all, John McCain, the Mick was reminiscent of Maccabees, and John was actually one of the Maccabees. And so that idea of John McCain also being involved in the latke meant that we couldn't really firmly associate Obama with the latke and McCain with the Hamantash. So we were left again with that unresolved. But one thing that's not really relevant but interesting that we discovered was that the election was on November 4th, which corresponded to the 7th of Cheshvan, put together 47. That actually corresponds to the word bama in Hebrew, which, of course, is part of the president's name. But it wasn't clear whether that had anything to do with the latke or the Hamantash, so that was unsuccessful. In the 63rd debate, that was the 150th anniversary of the origin of species, we tried to look at it from an evolutionary standpoint, but what we discovered was that it was also the 200th birthday of Darwin and also the 250th birthday of Lincoln. They share the same birthday, for those of you who don't know. So we tried to use that as sort of a portent or an omen to figure out could we associate one with one and one with the other, especially since Darwin and Lincoln are both Jewish, which we discovered, actually, by looking up on the internet, was Abraham Lincoln of Jewish ancestry? And if you can read it here, apparently his mother was from an ancestry that went back to England, specifically a town in England where mostly Jews were known to reside. And that's good enough for us. And in terms of Darwin, there really can't be any doubt if you look at his dress, which is very reminiscent of somebody else that we know, the Lubavitcher Rebbe. And it turns out that Darwin was actually one of the early Chabad emissaries to the Galapagos. And that explains why there's so many Jewish turtles and finches there. But more seriously, we actually looked at other signs of them. Here's Abraham Lincoln also in dress, reminiscent of that. We looked at his stovepipe hat, which, of course, looked at from above, was reminiscent of the latke. Darwin, on the other hand, has this iconic beard, which, of course, is reminiscent of the Hamantash. And so we could associate Lincoln with the latke and Darwin with the Hamantash, although that didn't really say which was superior. So we looked to a Jewish text, actually Genesis 1, which has a famous commentary by the Jewish commentator Rashi, the medieval commentator, who asks, why does the Torah, the Bible, start with Genesis? In fact, it should start with Exodus, because Exodus is really the story of the formation of the Jews as a people, whereas Genesis is really just about the creation of the world. And fundamentally, that is really the question of whether the origin of species or freeing of the slaves is the more important act, right? And so if we could determine that, then we would know which among Lincoln and Darwin was superior, and then we would know which was superior among the Latke and the Hamantash. But the fact of the matter is that on the one hand, the Torah does start with Genesis, and you could say that means Darwin, but really the Jewish people did start with Exodus, and so it really was, again, inconclusive. We tried one more time last year. I forgot this part. We also determined that numerologically, Lincoln and Darwin both actually equal the same number. So that was, again, it's the fact that this is so hard to determine is probably in itself an omen of some kind, although I'm not sure what it is an omen of. Last year we tried to look at the Torah itself. These are the five books of Moses, and we found that the Latke Hamantash debate, which always takes place on the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, can only fall within a certain band of the annual cycle of reading of the Torah that happens in Jewish synagogues. And what happens during that band? It's the Jacob and Esau story. And so, again, we try to correspond the Latke and the Hamantash to Jacob and Esau in different ways. Esau was hairy, like the Latke, but Jacob's, the heel bone, which Jacob's name comes from, it also looked like a potato. On the other hand, Esau was known as a hunter, and an arrowhead kind of looks like a Hamantash, but Jacob is called a tent dweller, sort of a homebody, and the tent looks like a Hamantash. So really, again, it was inconclusive. And so I had to sort of think back to the end, the 61st debate, where I talked about the traditional Jewish lifespan of 120 years. I thought at that time that perhaps that we were flipping to the 61st year. It was sort of the second half of the traditional Jewish lifespan. And so we were looking towards at the end of the Latke Hamantash debate, and it would finally be concluded. But then what I realized looking at that was that, again, using numerology or gematria, that we find that 61 actually corresponded to the letters Samech Aleph. But the Hebrew gematria is very different from, for example, Roman numerals, in that in Roman numerals, if you flip the letters, you get a different number. But in the Hebrew numerology, it's the same. And so Samech Aleph is the same as Aleph Samech, and that is well known to stand for Ein Sof, or endless, or infinite. And so what that means is that the Latke Hamantash debate will apparently never end, at least in terms of using Jewish sources to resolve the question, and that's why we turn to the great scholars of the University of Chicago to try to bring secular knowledge to bear on this important question. But before closing, I do want to say talk about one other Talmudic aphorism that may be relevant here. The rabbis teach us in the Talmud that a person who attributes a statement in the name of its original sayer, that is, a person who cites his sources and provides proper attribution, brings redemption to the world. So in a few moments, you'll hear these arguments by Professors Shapiro and Stone, who are known very much at this university for their academic integrity, and you'll hear many sources cited. And so, therefore, the redemption could come this afternoon. If it does come, I do want to point out that there are clearly marked exits on either side of the room, and I would ask you to follow the Messiah in an orderly fashion out of the room. But unfortunately, we are left at the end of my talk where we seem to always be left, which is the failure of Jewish sources to determine this question, and we are then therefore required to turn to these illustrious faculty members. Before we do, I would like to ask them to go and sit over there in the corner so that they won't have to, the other people won't have to crane their necks to see the slides. And I want to tell you that you will be given, or you might have already been given, a card. If you enjoy yourself today, you can fill out this card, and we'll send you a free DVD of the Origin of Species Latke Hamantash debate, which we had all professors that had to do with evolution in some way. So I think you'd really enjoy that, and we'd be really pleased to send it to you. So now I'd like to introduce our moderator, Ted Cohen. I have made fun of him often in introducing him in past years, tending to focus on his name and raising questions about whether he really does come from a priestly lineage, as his name Cohen would suggest. Cohen That means priest in Hebrew. But I'm not going to do that today. Instead, I want to tell you three things about him. First of all, he is the author of many important and prominent books, including Jokes, philosophical thoughts on joking matters. His most recent book, Thinking of Others, on the talent for metaphor. And finally, the great Latke Hamantash debate, our own book, which he wrote the foreword to and is available outside for sale. It's published by the University of Chicago Press. The second thing I want to talk about is an experience that my wife and I had a few years ago when we woke up sort of groggily in the morning and heard on NPR that somebody from our neighborhood had won the Nobel Peace Prize. And we didn't hear who it was, and we sort of thought to ourselves, well, who could it possibly be? And we thought perhaps it was Ted Cohen for his many, many years of work trying to bring peace between the debaters on this issue. But it turned out, as you know, that it was Barack Obama. But apparently they're giving him more freely now, and perhaps Ted will win next year. but in closing, I want to say that, in all seriousness, Ted really reminds me of both the Latke and the Hamantash. Like the Latke, his talks are always very delightful going in and stick with you for many days. And like the Hamantash, he may seem crusty on the outside, but he's actually very sweet on the inside. So, ladies and gentlemen, Ted Cohen.
Well, maybe we should go over there.
Yeah. Thank you. Not a whole lot of light. Well, that's all right. I know what this says. If you've attended earlier installments in this great debate, you know that my customary practice has been to tell you just what edition this is. I will not do that today, partly to save time, but also because it has become increasingly difficult to count. There is some disagreement about just when in the first half of the 20th century we got underway, and about whether there has been an installment every year since then. There is also the question of whether to count some off-calendar editions, including two in Manhattan, where we have tried with quite limited success to educate New Yorkers, one at the Humanities Festival, the Chicago Humanities Festival, and now there is this special one just for you. So let us leave that calculation of what number this might be to other scholars who will prove, once again, that garbage is garbage, but the history of garbage is scholarship. I content myself with telling you that this is the 5,771st year since the creation of the world. I am quite sure of that because we Jews are good with numbers and we have been counting. For those of you who have not attended early installments, I have a word of advice. Although I know today's speakers, I am largely unfamiliar with their work, and so I expect to hear things I have difficulty understanding. Perhaps you too will be bemused, especially because, not having attended the debate before today, you may find it difficult to follow the exceedingly abstruse reasoning about to be presented, and so let me adapt the piece of advice from a remark I received last summer. Last summer, my wife Andy and I were in Israel, and as usual, we preferred being in Jerusalem, but we did spend some time in Tel Aviv, and while there, we spent an evening at a nightclub. The main act was a stand-up comedian. Sitting near us was a New York Jew who laughed uncontrollably throughout the comic's act. This puzzled me, and so I said to him, "How can it be that you find all this so funny? You don't understand not one word of Hebrew, and that is the only language the comic used." The New York Jew replied, "It's okay. I trust these people." I trust today's debaters, and so can you. I will now introduce them. James Shapiro is professor of microbiology in the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology. The work for which Professor Shapiro is quite well known centers mainly on the chemistry of cells, their DNA, and other constituents. He has been especially concerned with understanding how cells, so to speak, cooperate, and is the author of the paper given at Exeter, I'm not making this up, "Bacteria Are Small, But Not Stupid." Thus, he has been engaged in socio-microbiology and has made great strides in understanding how individual cells, seemingly unintelligent, and utterly uninterested in one another, managed to work together for a common purpose. For this reason, he is currently being asked for help by the Republican Party. But I do not know whether he will agree to act as their consultant. Professor Shapiro is just now publishing a monumental book, the title of which is Evolution, A View from the 21st Century. And although it is not yet available from Amazon, I note that Amazon already lists its sales number, which is slightly below 3 million. I note that the book comes with an endorsement from a professor at Haifa, and so I'm sure the book is trustworthy. I think the book, Evolution, A View from the 21st Century, explains in stunning and very complex detail how it happens that the 21st century follows the 20th. In biology, as in physics, it has been my experience that its practitioners tend to work either on very small things or larger things. And not many scientists have the talent and interest to work on both. Professor Shapiro was one of those multi-talented researchers, and along with his work on the very, very tiny, tiny objects of molecular biology, he has retained an interest in the ordinary, reasonably sized creatures that inhabit the animal world. To this end, he supervises work in a little-known laboratory devoted to the creation of animals, including humans, with the principal characteristics of both sexes. I suppose it is premature to make the announcement, but I will do so, and you are very lucky to be the very first audience to learn of this. Professor Shapiro's group has now, as of the week before last, succeeded in breeding a human being that possesses the salient features of both males and females. This creature has both a penis and a brain. Amazing. No less amazing, I'm sure, will be Professor Shapiro's presentation today, and I am very proud to introduce him.
Well, thank you, Ted. I have to say that bacteria are small but not stupid, and Republicans are large, and I think I'll leave the rest of the sentence unfinished. I'd like to talk to you today about the Humantashen and about its genetics, its development, its reproduction. I included a copy of the cover of my forthcoming book only because we had a great problem in doing the cover design until I discovered the photograph, which is on the bottom of the cover. And when you look at the site where I got the picture, it says it's a mimetic moth from Costa Rica. But at the Howard Hughes Humantash Institute, or HHI, we've discovered that it's actually a mimetic Humantashen copying a mimetic moth, copying something with two eyes and a nose. So that's very fortunate and brings us to our theme. Now, it may be that from Jewish lore, one cannot distinguish between the Latke and the Humantash, but by genomics and DNA analysis, it's really quite a simple matter. The Latke has a miserable genome of only 5 million base pairs. It only has a single chromosome, and 90% of its DNA is just repetitive DNA. It's Gimel-Hay, all the way down for hundreds of thousands of base pairs. And it only has three identifiable genetic loci. In genetics, we use three-letter codes to signify what genetic loci stand for, and these three mnemonics stand for onion, starch, and schmaltz. Now, the Humantashen, on the other hand, is a very complex organism. It has 589 million base pairs in its genome. It has 32 chromosomes. I won't go into the sex chromosomes, although they are quite fascinating. It's been completely sequenced, and it has a very complex genomic composition. 35% of the DNA is unique. 5% of it is simple repeats, as opposed to 90% in the poor Latke. 20% is tandem repeats, and 40% are dispersed repeats of more than 100 different families. And there are 33,784 different genetic loci which have been identified. And I should remind you that we only have about 23,000. So the Hamantashian is genetically, from that point of view, more complex than we are. It comes in three different species, compatibility complexes, which are called MD, PR, and AP. That stands for munt, prune, and apricot. And very elaborate developmental biological studies have identified several different morphogenetic networks, the chorionic binding system, the neocortical binding complex, the anterior binding building complex, and the follicular opercular xyloplasm, otherwise known as CBS, NBC, ABC, and FOX. Now, if we look in a simplified way at the morphology of the Hamantashian, we can distinguish the cortex in the middle, which is what distinguishes the three different groups. One is from the munt group on the left and from the prune group on the right. The cortex is similar, but the endoplasm, which is what distinguishes the two different types. Now, generally, the Hamantashian comes in a triangular form, but occasionally there's a developmental mistake and they're bilaterally symmetrical, and so you get a rare symmetrical variant, and here is one illustrated for your interest. These things are quite rare, and as you'll see later, they're incapable of reproducing because they need that third side for reproduction. Hamantashian can be quite different in their behavior. This is an aggressive male Hamantashian, seen close up in a threatening posture. And if you follow the cortical development of the Hamantashian, you can perceive certain different developmental stages. On the beginning, there's an undifferentiated cell mass covered with some white material. That gets thinned out and formed into a sheet or epithelium, so we call that stage epithelialization. And then a very mysterious process occurs, which we don't know the basis of, where circles are cut out from the epithelium, and then the rest of the epithelium undergoes programmed cell death or apoptosis, and you're left with these circular forms. What follows is that then the endoplasm develops, and when the endoplasm is developed, then we have these post-endoplasmic invaginations. You can see here on the bottom that there's a single fold, and then on the right you see all three folds have been completed. And so this is the process of morphogenesis of the Hamantashian. This is just a nubile female Hamantashian viewed just before the final invagination stage at the back, where the sexual activity goes on. We've spent a lot of time, as you might imagine, looking at Hamantashian mating. The first step is that the two Hamantashian come near each other, they encounter each other, then they engage in foreplay, and the final stage, of course, is coitus, or mating. And you can see the form that the sexually active Hamantashian take. It's a very interesting form, and I think it has some significance. What it is, we're not entirely clear yet, but we're trying to learn. Now, one of the problems is when you see mating Hamantashian is to identify which is the male and which is the female. And we've only succeeded in doing this by observing the post-mating behavior. So you can see two Hamantashian which engage in mating behavior. Here it's a cross between the munt variety and the apricot variety. To tell which one is the male, you have to look after mating. And here it's quite clear that the munt is the male of the pair. So we have another case here where we suspected that the small Hamantashian was the male and was using a flower to attract the female. We followed the process of foreplay, coitus, and then after post-mating, we actually confirmed that it was the small Hamantashen that was the male. So you can see that the study of the sex life of Hamantashen is filled with surprises and delights. Now, there's ethnic diversity that we've discovered amongst the Hamantashen. So this is one ethnic group, and we've decided to call these the Buddhists. And here's another ethnic group, which we've decided to call the Christians of the Orthodox variety. Hamantashen display various social behaviors. One of them is flocking, especially on elaborately designed ceramic surfaces. But when they aggregate together like this, of course, they're subject to predation. Unless, of course, they discovered the kind of mimicry shown by the one on the book cover, in which case nothing would come and predate them because you'd be afraid of getting bitten. Now, as we look at the sites in nature where Hamantashen are observed and found, and in particular where fossil Hamantashen are found, we've done some archaeology and we've come up with a variety of artifacts, a text and some kind of hieroglyphics, which we think explains the ingredients and processes. And so we've come to wonder, is there in fact intelligent design at work in the origin of the Hamantashen? And to conclude now, I would just like to make my acknowledgments. I would like to thank my wife, Joan, on the left here for her collaboration, and we worked on this project together, and most of the creations you saw were produced by her own hands. And this is a technician named Nancy, who is currently looking for a better job. So thank you very much.
Oops. Jeffrey Stone is professor in the law school, where he also edits the Supreme Court Review. Professor Stone reports, we have some serious stuff here, that he was born in the Bronx in 1946. His grandfather on one side owned a luncheonette, the other grandfather drove a cab. One grandmother delivered ice, the other one worked in a hat factory. Little did they know, this is true, that their grandson would go on to be the only law school dean in American history to hire to the faculty both a future African-American president of the United States and a Jewish woman that president would appoint to the Supreme Court. Only in America. I am personally acquainted with a number of attorneys. My son Amos is one. In fact, he practices in Brooklyn. And my old University of Chicago College classmate, James Zagel, is even now, as the sitting judge, conducting the Chicago circus known as the Rod Blagojevich retrial. But even knowing those people, I have never been sure just what is taught in law schools until Professor Stone explained. A law school, he pointed out, is in the business of teaching its students to form corporations, which are artificial people empowered to cause harm to actual citizens. As you no doubt already know, our law school excels at this, although its strength in this respect was diminished when Antonin Scalia left the school in order to join the federal bench. It may surprise you to hear that Professor Stone expects the world to end soon with the arrival of the Mashiach. No, of course, he is not persuaded by that Meshuggah who said the world would end last month on the strength of riddles he claims to find in the Bible. What Professor Stone has noted is that the world surely is coming to an end now that the 9 members of the Supreme Court are 6 Catholics and 3 Jews, not a single Protestant. Oy, said Professor Stone, not a single Protestant on the High Court. It's the end of the world. There is still time, however, for today's proceedings, and Professor Stone surely will make our final days well worth having. It's my pleasure to present him.
Thank you, Ted. There we go. Oye, oye. God or Zimmer, save this honorable court. I now call this court into session, and justices, you guys, presiding. And with that, I will remove my judicial robes and assume my advocacy position. Assuming I can get this off. Okay. There. Okay, Your Honors, my client's position, oops. Here we go. My client's position, which I shall advocate with all the rigor of the most spurious legal reasoning, is that the Latke has historically been the driving force behind the constitutional protection of free speech, whereas the Hamantash has been a dangerous force for censorship and repression. Put simply, the Latke is the Judah Maccabee of the First Amendment, the Hamantash, the Haman. Consider first. Consider first Abrams versus United States. During World War I, the United States sent a contingent of Marines to Vladivostok. The defendants in the Abrams case, a group of Russian Jewish immigrants who were self-proclaimed socialists and anarchists, perceived this expedition as an attempt by the United States government to crush the Russian Revolution. In protest, they threw several thousand copies of each of two leaflets, one in English, the other in Yiddish, from a rooftop in the Lower East Side of New York. The leaflets called for a general strike. The defendants, Jacob Abrams and Molly Steimer, were promptly arrested by the military police, and after a circus-like trial, they were convicted of conspiring to obstruct the war effort. The trial judge sentenced each of them to 20 years in prison. The defendants appealed to the Supreme Court of the United States, claiming that the convictions violated the First Amendment. The court disagreed. But what's memorable about Abrams is not the court's Hamantashian-ish opinion, but the brilliant dissenting opinion of that great Hasidic scholar, Oliver Wendell Holmes. It was Holmes's dissenting opinion that our constitutional protection of free speech first found full articulation. Holmes wrote, "Persecution for the expression of opinion seems to me perfectly logical, but when men have realized that time has upset many fighting faiths, they may come to believe, even more than they believe the very foundations of their own conduct, that the ultimate good desired is better reached by free trade and ideas, that the best test of truth is the power of the thought to get itself accepted in the competition of the market. That," he said, "at any rate, is the theory of our Constitution." Now you ask, what does all this have to do with Latkes? Well, I'll tell you, but first it's essential to understand that what really pissed off Holmes in Abrams was not so much the conviction, but the severity of the punishment of the defendants. As he explained, and I quote, "In this case, sentences of 20 years imprisonment have been imposed for the publishing of two leaflets. Even if I am wrong in concluding that no crime has been committed, it seems to me that the most nominal punishment is all that possibly could be inflicted, unless the defendants are to be made to suffer not for their pathetic attempt to call a strike, but for the creed that they avow, a creed that no one should consider." So what inspired Holmes's brilliant dissent was his suspicion that the defendants in the case were being punished not because they posed any real danger to the war effort, but because of the offensiveness of their ideas. But how do they know this? Listen to the statement of the trial judge just before sentencing the defendants. Again, I quote, "These defendants took the stand. They talked about capitalists and producers, and I tried to figure out what a capitalist and what a producer is as contemplated by them. After listening carefully to all they had to say, I came to the conclusion that a capitalist is a man with a decent set of clothes, a minimum of $1.25 in his pocket, and a good character. And when I tried to find out what the prisoners had produced, I was unable to find out anything at all. So far as I can learn, not one of them has ever produced so much as a single potato." That's true. And there it is, the potato. And what sort of potato are we speaking of here? Remember, these were Russian Jewish emigres. Why would they raise a potato? to make vichyssoise, to make potatoes au gratin. Ridiculous. The only reason they would raise a potato is to make latkes. But if, as the trial judge declared, they did not raise even a single potato, what does this tell us? It tells us that the defendants did not like latkes. And it was this that offended the trial judge. It was this creed of the defendants that led to the severity of their punishment. And it was thus latkes that ultimately led Justice Holmes to write his eloquent defense of free speech, known ever since as the marketplace of potatoes theory of the First Amendment. Now, as a blue-blood Hasidic scholar, Holmes was, of course, a committed devotee of the latke. And keeping in mind the defendant's creed of anti-latkeism, it's thus understandable that during the course of his dissenting opinion, Holmes described the defendants as puny anonymities and condemned their creed as the creed of ignorance and immaturity. Indeed, at one point, Holmes went so far as to attack the defendants' anti-latkeism as, and I quote, a creed we loathe and believe to be fraught with death. It's noteworthy that Holmes' deep personal contempt for the defendants, disdain for latkes, makes even more impressive his willingness to protect their advocacy of such a creed. But the role of the latke in Abrams runs even deeper, for only one other justice joined Justice Holmes' dissenting opinion, the first Jewish justice, Louis Brandeis. Brandeis, of course, earned his reputation before being appointed to the Supreme Court by fighting the infamous Hamantash Trust in Boston. It was Brandeis who single-handedly crushed this cartel, which had conspired to corner, indeed to tri-corner, the Hamantash market. It was through this triumph that Brandeis earned his lifelong nickname, Louis the Latke Brandeis. Now, you may not know this, but when Brandeis first was nominated to the Supreme Court, he was bitterly opposed by anti-Semites, who did their best to defeat his appointment. When Brandeis finally assumed his seat on the court, Justice James McReynolds, a well-known anti-Semite, refused to speak with Brandeis during the entire time that they served together. It's noteworthy that McReynolds' biographer described him, and I quote, as gaunt, tight-lipped, and prune-faced. He was, indeed, a veritable Hamantash on stilts. I'd like now to move to another great decision in the evolution of our free speech tradition, New York Times versus United States, the Pentagon Papers case. In June of 1971, a former Pentagon official, Daniel Ellsberg, another socially conscious Jewish kid, gave the New York Times and the Washington Post a top secret Defense Department study. Upon learning of this leak, the Nixon administration immediately sought to enjoin the Times and the Post from eating or publishing the material. Within days, the case worked itself to the Supreme Court, which held that the First Amendment prohibits any such prior restraint. As Justice Black explained, in the First Amendment, the framers gave the free speech, gave the free press the protection it must have to fulfill its essential role in our democracy. The press was to serve the governed, not the governors. The press was protected so that it could bear the secrets of government and inform the people. Think how far the Supreme Court had come from 1919, when defendants in Abrams received 20-year sentences for distributing their puny leaflets, to 1971, when two major newspapers were held to have a constitutional right to publish excerpts from a stolen top-secret report in the face of government claims that publication would seriously jeopardize the national security. But what explains this transformation? Latkes, of course. To understand this phenomenon, it's essential to note that the critical precedent for the court's highly speech-protective decision in the Pentagon Papers case was its decision 40 years earlier in a case called Neer versus Minnesota. In Neer, a state court issued an injunction prohibiting any further publication of a weekly magazine, the Saturday Press, because it had run a series of articles falsely asserting that a mob of Jewish gangsters was in control of bootlegging in Minneapolis. In reversing the injunction, the Supreme Court held that such prior restraints on expression are unconstitutional. It was this principle, first stated in 1931 in Neer, that provided the foundation for the Pentagon Papers decision some 40 years later. But note, the allegation that led to the litigation in Neer was that the Saturday Post had falsely reported that Jewish gangsters were in control of bootlegging in Minneapolis. Now I ask you, What does one use to make bootleg liquor? Potatoes, of course. But we know that the Saturday Press's charge was false. So the suspected gangsters were not making illegal liquor. What then were they doing with all those potatoes? The answer, of course, again, is clear. What would a gaggle of Jews be doing with truckloads of potatoes? Making latkes, of course. The real gang. And so it was that a group of humble latke manufacturers in Minnesota in 1931 managed to bring about the Pentagon Papers decision in 1971, which in turn led to the break-in of Daniel Ellsberg's psychiatrist's office, which in turn led to the discovery of the White House plumbers, which in turn led to Watergate, which in turn led to the resignation of Richard Nixon. The lowly latke marching through time. A note, by the way, that Richard Nixon's favorite midnight snack was a prune Danish smothered in ketchup. Okay, the third decision I'd like to call to your attention is New York Times versus Sullivan, a decision that was once described by Harry Calvin, my own teacher when I was a student at our law school, as an occasion for dancing in the streets. New York Times v. Sullivan arose out of the civil rights movement. L.B. Sullivan, the sheriff of Montgomery, Alabama, widely known as the town of 1,000 Hamantashen, brought a libel action against four black clergymen in the New York Times. LB claimed that he'd been libeled by an advertisement that had been published by the clergyman in the Times. The ad described the civil rights movement and appealed for funds. Sullivan claimed that several statements in the advertisement were false. Specifically, he objected to the following passage, and I quote, "In Montgomery, Alabama, after students sang 'My Country, 'Tis of Thee' on the steps of the state capitol, their leaders were expelled from school, and truckloads of police armed with shotguns and tear gas ringed the Alabama State College campus. When the entire student body protested state authorities by refusing to re-register, their dining hall was padlocked in an attempt to starve them into submission." That was the text of the advertisement seeking funds for the civil rights movement. LB claimed that this was false in three respects. First, the students, he said, had sung not "My Country, 'Tis of Thee," but the national anthem. This is true. Second, not the entire student body, but only most of it, had protested the expulsion. And third, the students had been expelled not for leading a demonstration at the Capitol, but for demanding service at a segregated lunch counter. Now, one might think that these errors border on the trivial, but a fairly appointed Alabama jury found in favor of LB and awarded him damages in the amount of $500,000. Note this was 1964, when $500,000 was real money. Indeed, in 1964, $500,000 would have paid the full tuition of every student at the University of Chicago. Happily, the U.S. Supreme Court reversed, noting that, quote, "We consider this case against the background of a profound national commitment to the principle that debate on public issues should be uninhibited, robust, and wide open. The court held the damage award unconstitutional and sent LB packing." And so you ask, again, what does this have to do with this debate? Well, recall that a key issue in the dispute concerned the allegation that the expelled students had demanded service at a segregated lunch counter. This was at a time when segregation was rampant in the South. So I want you to close your eyes for a moment and imagine the scene. It's a hot summer day in Montgomery. Nine black students defiantly seat themselves at the segregated counter. They place their order. The proprietor glares at them with hatred in his eyes. He points to the sign over the counter. It reads, "We do not serve latkes, Hamantash only." Oh, sure, they claimed it was separate but equal. They said the students could get latkes down the street, but in the town of 1,000 Hamantashen, separate was not equal. And consider the other allegation that was central to the case, the statement that truckloads of police ringed the campus when the students' dining hall was padlocked in an attempt to starve them into submission. Let me read you a full account of that incident, published the next day in the Montgomery Daily Dreidel. Quote, "It was brutally hot on the campus of Alabama State College. Dust, tinged with the sweet aroma of tear gas, swirled in the air as more than 100 of Montgomery's finest munch Hamantashen while standing guard over campus property. The college had justly locked its Negro students out of the dining hall, and the students were hopping mad. At one point, a mob of Negro troublemakers crowded by the padlocked dining hall and chanted, "Aleph Bet Gimel Dalet, our faith in law is solid. Give us bagels, give us locks, give us latkes by the box. We are starving, we need noshin. Keep your lousy Hamantash." The final decision I'll offer to prove my thesis is Cohn versus California. Paul Robert Cohn, another nice Jewish boy, was convicted of disturbing the peace for wearing a button in the Los Angeles County Courthouse in 1968 bearing the words, when the case made its way to the Supreme Court, it posed a problem for Chief Justice Warren Burger. Burger, you see, did not want the word fuck uttered in the hallowed chambers of his court. So when Cohn's attorney approached the podium to begin his argument, the Chief Justice casually leaned over the bench and said, "Counsel, we're all familiar with the facts in this case, so you can just move right ahead to your legal argument." Cohn's counsel, yet another nice Jewish boy, Mel Nimmer, knew that it was important to his case for him to be able to utter the word fuck, so he responded, "Of course, Mr. Chief Justice, I agree entirely. Suffice it to say that my client has been punished for wearing a jacket bearing a button with the words, fuck the draft." Now, it's an interesting, that's a true story. Now, it's an interesting and little known footnote in the saga of Cohn v. California that in a subtle effort to put the justices in a more progressive state of mind, Nimmer wore a specially designed tie in order to affect their views. In the court's opinion, noting that one man's vulgarity is another man's lyric, the court, in an opinion by Justice Harlan, held that Cohn's conviction violated the First Amendment. And it's interesting to note, in a recently discovered earlier draft of Harlan's opinion, the phrase "one man's vulgarity is another man's lyric" originally appeared as "one man's Hamantash is another man's latke." Harlan apparently changed the language, however, after Chief Justice Burger returned his copy of the draft to Harlan, having scribbled in the margin, "What the fuck are these?" Up to now, I've given several, I think, compelling examples of the central role latkes have played in the development of our constitutional protection of free speech. But what of the other side of the argument? What of the dark side? What of the Hamantash? Because I'm about out of time, I will offer just one of many possible examples. This case involved a particularly fascinating twist on the freedom of speech, the right not to speak. It came about like this. The Jewish owner of a shopping center did not want to permit individuals opposing Zionism to distribute leaflets in his shopping center, but a state law prohibited him from throwing the bums out. The shopping center owner argued that this violated his First Amendment right not to speak. In an opinion written by Justice Rehnquist, often referred to in legal circles as Justice Antiochus, the Supreme Court rejected this claim. It'll interest you to know that the name of this decision was Robbins versus Pruneyard. Pruneyard, check it out. It's at volume 47 of the United States Reports, Emmis. Okay, as a final measure of legal reasoning, I decided to perform an independent check of my theory. Latkes for freedom, Hamantash for repression, with three phone calls. First, I called my former colleague on the faculty of the law school, Justice Antonin Scalia. "Nino," I said, "tell me, which do you prefer, latkes or Hamantash?" Scalia replied, "Huh?" "You know," I said, "Hanukkah and Purim, the Jewish holidays." Scalia replied, "Huh?" "Nino," I said, "you're a good Catholic. Let me put it this way. A latke is a potato pancake. It looks like those funny little wafers you Catholics eat at Mass, but it tastes a lot better. A Hamantash is a prune pastry. It has three sides, kind of like the Trinity." Nino replied, "Huh?" "Damn it, Nino. Which do you like better, potatoes or prunes?" At this point, Nino lost his temper, as he always does when he's confounded. Wait. Sorry. I better take that. Hello? Nino? Yeah. Hi, how you doing? Yeah, the debate, right, it's today. Yeah, I promise, I won't say anything about you. No question. No problem. I promised it would be off the record. Okay, right. Okay, go back to ruining the country. Good talking to you. It's a pain in the ass. Okay, then I called another former colleague of mine on the law school faculty, Supreme Court Justice Elena Kagan. Now I was on familiar turf. Now I could deal with a Jew. There would be no confusion here. Moreover, now I would know the answer to the question so many of us have pondered. Who is this new justice? Is she a Brennan or is she a Scalia? Will she be a force for freedom or for repression? I would be the first to know. Elena, I said, tell me, which do you prefer, Latkes or Hamantash? Oh, Jeff, she responded, that's an interesting question. Can I think about it for a while? No, I replied, I need an answer now. Okay, Elena said, I like prune pancakes. Damn. Finally, I decided to go to the big guy. I went to another former colleague of mine at the law school. I went to the decider. And so with this, I rest my case. It all comes down to what the great legal realists of the early years of the 20th century first recognized. If you want to understand the law, you need not look to principles or precedents, policies or prescriptions. You don't even have to know Latin. All you really have to know is what the judge ate for breakfast. And where the First Amendment is concerned, the lesson is clear. The proof is in the pancake. Thank you.
Well, we have nearly finished. We've given only a fraction of the wonders available at our regular occasions, where we have more time, but I'm sure this has been enough for today's enlightenment. You may, as you know, obtain more by acquiring that book published not long ago by the U of C Press, namely The Great Latke Hamantash Debate, a compendium of lectures given not only in this debate over many years, but in a number of other debates that have mimicked this. There's one at MIT, there's one at the University of Michigan. They're all over the place. They're not as good as this one, but some of their entries have been pretty good, and they're in that collection. At our regular debates, we take a post-debate poll to discover whether Latkes or Hamantash have prevailed, but in fact, we pay no attention whatever to the results, and so today we can simply dispense with that vote. Surely you know that what matters is the debate itself going on ceaselessly. Even if and when the world ends, there will be this debate. Perhaps you know, do you, that the inspiration for this event derives in part from the very old tradition of Purim spielen, occasions during Purim when yeshiva students made parodic fun of their own studies. It dates all the way back to the Middle Ages. Did you also know that according to the Talmud, at the end of days, the only holiday we will continue to observe is Purim? Why Purim? I have no idea. But I am sure that even after the coming of the Messiah and the end of worldly days, this debate will continue. And so I can assure you that even if Professor Stone is right in telling us that the event is at hand, you can come again and again and again. Thank you for coming this time. We are now adjourned.